I could build a spaceship.
Hello and welcome to Space Drokk Jury Minisode number 19.
So you got the number right, but this time...
what type of episode it's going to be.
Yeah.
I tell you what, ladies and gentlemen, it's been a very, very long day for us both.
Yeah.
I'm Lee.
I'm Peter.
And this week, Andy is away quelling a riot on the prison moon of Titan. Because
serves him right for making that replica costume.
Yeah, exactly.
He didn't realise that meant he got...
impersonating a judge, 25 years in the cubes, yeah.
Yeah.
Oh, dear. And, that kind of rather tenuous link goes into what we're talking about for this minisode.
Yes, because there's a big event coming up in the comics world, because 2000 AD is about to hit its 2000th prog. Well, at time of recording, it'll have already come out by the time this comes out, I guess.
Yeah, but more than likely, but
our timing always sucks.
yeah, that's the problem with recording in advance. We kind of get the general month it's coming out, but not necessarily right on the money. So this week, because Andy's off doing his thing, and we've well, more actually, you, Pete, you've brought up a few 2000 AD ships in the past, haven't you?
Mm-hmm. Yep, yes, two of them. So,
and in both instances, we've discussed it, and Andy sat there with literally zero frame of reference, Donnie.
Yeah.
So we thought, well, while he's away, it's a good time to talk not only about the spaceships within 2000 AD, which are vague at best.
Yeah, slightly limited, we've discovered.
But also the comic itself.
I mean, that's part of the problem is that, you know, comics with spaceships in there, you haven't got an awful lot of choice, really, because, yes, it's 2000 AD, but as we'll be talking about, there aren't that many, actually. They tend to focus more on the characters.
Mm.
Then you had, Star Wars comic. Well, obviously, we've covered quite a few of those ships in the process of the podcast so far. There's the arc in Transformers, but we don't mention that.
Well, not anymore.
Now that it's
buried firmly in the side of a mountain.
Yeah, Guardians of the Galaxy has some nice ships, but not very many. Mm. That's about it, really. I couldn't think of any other comics that feature lots of spaceships.
Well, actually, I've just found one which ties nicely into 2000 AD as well. So maybe we should get underway, and then we can talk this up. So there you go. So. Obviously, 2000 AD, it's been going since the 70s now, isn't it?
Yep.
So what anniversary is it now? 40th? Oh, I guess it's not the 40th, is it? 2000 progs, it's just 2000 weeks. So before we get to the ships, because frankly, the ships are limited. I mean, when did you first read the comic?
I'm pretty sure I picked up a copy in the dentist's waiting room when I was a kid. Would have been in the early 80s, maybe even the late 70s.
Oh, blimey.
That was my introduction to 2000 AD. It was impending dentistry.
not something you really want to be bringing.
But, you know, I don't know if they still do. I've not noticed. These days, dentists have television screens, don't they? And everybody's glued to the box. But back in the day, you didn't have such high-tech things as TV screens in the dentist's waiting room. You had comics or... most part magazines, obviously, for the adults, but they were usually sprinkled. And, you know, back in our day, it was like war comics for the most part, you know, Victory, Battle and all that stuff.
Oh, God,
but if you were lucky, you had 2000 AD or maybe a Star Wars comic there to sink your teeth into. And that, I think that's probably where I first read my first issue. I remember Rogue Trooper particularly hitting me as an interesting...
Rogue Trooper, yeah. Now, I mean, okay, well, I mean, that's a good one to seek into spaceships, isn't it, really?
I mean, yeah, except it's mostly about ground battles, sadly. I mean, it's kind of a take, it's a mixture of the First World War, Second World War. You've got two armies facing off each other on a planet that they've kind of forgotten the reason for the conflict, and it's just grinding on and on.
Yeah.
Occasionally you get spaceships. I remembered them being better than they were. I went back and read Volume 1 today, or at least some of it.
Mm.
And there's the ones that dropped... because Rogue Trooper is a genetic infantryman, and they get dropped on a planet, and there's a massive massacre, and he's the only one left. Mm. And the ship that dropped them, it was a box with a couple of cannons on it. Really wasn't very exciting.
Yeah, it was just more just like drop them, because the genetic infantrymen were effectively they were clone troopers, weren't they?
Mm-hmm.
And so they were utterly disposable. So yeah, so the spaceships weren't exactly designed for their safety in the first place, even the dropships.
Yeah, a lot of them crashed or got shot on the way down. And yeah. Again, it was all very First World War over the trenches stuff. And literally, but, you know, at the end of it, it's thousands of them and there's only one or two left.
Yeah.
Certainly one that the strip concentrates on then. And of course, the interesting thing about Rogue Trooper is a lot of these buddies then get reduced to the chips
that they
inserted in his gun, in his hat, and his backpack. That seemed really, really cool. And you get lots of really cool tanks. If you're into space tanks, then Rogue Trooper's the strip for you, but less so spaceships, sadly. Yeah. The only other one that I came across flicking through the pages was one of the baddie ships.
Yeah, the Noughts, they were called, weren't they?
And, well, it's a wonder they weren't sued, really, because I'll put an image of this on the Facebook. It's basically a Star Destroyer, isn't it?
Yeah, I mean, the picture that Pete sent me, I'll just describe it because it looks like someone's traced over a shot from Empire Strikes Back with the dozen or so sort of Star Destroyers, and then what they've done is they've just literally take the engines of the Star Destroyer and just moved them sort of a little bit higher off the nose, the back,
and then giving it a big cannon like the Iron Cannon,
exactly
right at the front.
Yeah, the Iron Cannon from Hoth has just been bolted to the bottom of it. I mean, it's
subtly ent.
No, you can tell what they were watching 5 minutes before they. Yeah, I'm surprised there wasn't like a snowstorm on New Earth at the time. Yeah,
probably was.
Yeah, they weren't known for their subtlety or their originality in these comics, to be honest.
Well, some of the time, I mean, because they're quite often against tight deadlines. I mean, the level of detail in that particular panel isn't exactly high. Obviously, you can tell that was just put together in 5 minutes' time. There are probably only two or three panels that had those ships in, so there was no point going to town and designing something cool. Unfortunately,
yeah. So that is, as you say, that's part of the problem, isn't it? I mean, all of the ships that, I mean, especially even like the Blitz Spear, which we brought up a few episodes ago, you know, they're a means to an end, aren't they?
They're very much scenery. They're not the front and center in the strips, with the exception of Ace Trucking, of course, where it was all about the rig.
Yeah, the Speedo Ghost, which was probably the only ship I know that's been named after, as well as the Blitz Spear.
That has got a decent name, yes. I mean, the other famous one, of course, is Justice One, which is features in Judge Dredd, and is what the judges use when the rare occasions they go into space. There's a big serial called the Quest for the Judge Child, and that involves traveling through space. And, they use Justice One for that, and it's a nice design. It reflects the judges nicely. I don't need to send you that, do I?
No, I know exactly what that looks like.
And it's got the big eagle at the front as well, which is completely impractical, but, you know, it fits in with the daft armour. Oh, did I say daft? Sorry. Oh, Andy's not here, doesn't matter.
No, it's okay, you're fine. plus, it's not the movie armour, so you're fine.
That's true. Not the first movie, certainly, yeah.
Yeah.
And then it's got Justice One in large letters along the side as well. You know what it reminds me of, actually, looking at the picture now? If you ignore the front, it's definitely the God Phoenix, isn't it?
Yes.
They've just taken the God Phoenix and stuck a pointy thing on the front.
That is exactly what I was about to say. You just shot me down in flames. The one thing I was about to say about it, it's like it literally is the God Phoenix, but they've just taken like two of the wing. They've taken two extra bits of the spans at the back, the tail spans. They've taken those off and that's it.
Yeah.
That's, yeah.
Oh. Yeah, if I'd have taken this for a full episode, it would just be scoring very badly on realization.
Pretty darn badly, if I'm honest. I mean, you know, that is always the problem, though, isn't it? It's, you know, it's, I mean, it's like there's a spaceship in one of my favorite ever stories, which is DR and Quinch.
Oh yes.
And but that again is kind of like what they did was essentially it's a land speeder, and then they just drew, you know, from New Hope, and they just took the wings off the edges, and then just drew a hot rod face on it.
Well, I think it's a bit of a cheek, really, to complain that 2000 AD ripping people off. I mean, they very rarely did. They did have Dan Dare for a while, of course, famously. He didn't start in 2000 AD, but it was the same publisher, and he did spend a bit of time in 2000 AD. And here's a frame from Dan Dare, and I'll put this on the Facebook.
Oh, look, What's that right at the bottom there?
It's Space Drokk, the comic, isn't it?
It's Space Drokk. Yeah, ladies and gentlemen, I mean, it's quite funny, actually, because basically, if you look at it, it's look up on the first page of what's called Dandare, the Doomsday Machine. And what you've got in the shot is you've got an eagle from Space 1999. Then you've actually got Dandare's ship, which is the Anastasia, which is down there. Then you've got something that looks very, very similar to a certain USS Enterprise.
It's even got NCC written on the front as well.
Exactly. You've got something that looks very, very close as well to Thunderbird 3 up the back. And then on top of that, there's something else. I'm trying to see what it is with a big wing. Oh, it looks like a bat wing or something.
I'm not sure what that is.
Yeah.
I think that might actually be an original creation, shockingly.
Shockingly. And yeah.
There's a bit of an X-wing at the front as well.
That's right. Yep. There's an X-wing down the bottom there. And then also you've got Maria from Metropolis.
Front and center. They probably thought they wouldn't sue.
And you know what? Do you want to know even funnier than that? The picture of Dandare at the very top, which is a silhouette, is actually a frame from Empire Strikes Back that someone's painted over. That's Harrison Ford.
Yeah, it does look very Harrison Ford.
It's like that's rip-off central.
They're not at all lazy. No.
Well, they put some effort in, didn't they? I mean, let's be honest. They looked up a few spaceships.
If you're going to steal from the best, I guess.
Which is quite funny because it actually says, you know, this huge alien vessel has captured the Anastasia in a beam of light. And it goes on, while the space vault is a formidable craft, it's dwarfed, even by Earth standards, it's dwarfed into insignificance by all this presence of other spaceships around it, which kind of implies that all of these things are in the same universe.
Yeah, which is, if I'd seen that as a kid, I'd have been so excited.
I mean,
that would be mind-blowing.
Yeah, that's amazing. Though, obviously, I mean, you know, we might have a little issue with the scale, seeing as it looks like...
and the way that the Enterprise is just kind of sitting there.
Yeah, it's just balancing on its secondary hull and
not... quite how that works about it rolling over to one side or the other, I don't know.
No, that's right. At this point, if we use this for reference, I think Thunderbird 3 would have done quite well, looking at the size of it compared to everything else. Wow. Yeah, so the art robot for that is a guy called Goreen Leech. Yes.
I think probably one of them did the tracing.
Yeah. Exactly. Well, I mean, I was going to bring up the Anastasia because that's actually an old, proper old-fashioned Dandare ship, and they've got stats and that and everything on that one.
Yes, and it's got that sort of, not retro, because back when it was first written, that was pretty much the look of the future, wasn't it?
But yeah.
It looks retro now as a result. It looks like something that was designed in the 60s.
Yeah, I'm just sending you a link to it while I describe it for the listeners. I mean, in fairness, it just looks like a rounded-off Saturn V rocket with two big frog eyes.
Yeah, the frog eyes are unfortunate, aren't they?
Yeah, and then it also has two sort of wings that look like they've come off of like a 1940s fighter plane.
Along with the undercarriage as well.
Which really severely dates it.
But they've got huge red leather chairs.
Well, that's, which is not not a ripoff from Thunderbirds at all, honest gov. I mean, but it's quite interesting because I think interior-wise, I mean, looking at this thing, I mean, looking at the picture I've just sent you, mm-hmm. This would actually do quite well for realisation.
Oh, yeah. I mean, they've gone to some trouble with that, haven't they?
Mm.
That's probably when it was in the Eagle. Well, 2018,
yeah, in fairness. But, it's another ship that... I mean, Dandare didn't feature for very long in 2000 AD, as I recall. It got resurrected twice in 2000 AD. Because I started reading from basically episode one. Prog number one.
Oh, wow.
Yeah. When Judge Dredd wasn't even on the front cover.
And yeah.
It was
with Star-Lord and things like that.
Yeah, you had Star-Lord and you had the Harlem Heroes, I think they were on the front cover.
Yeah.
And, Dredd was on the second cover and it came with a... I always remember this because I basically destroyed it trying to get it off. But it was a plastic spinner.
Oh, yeah.
Yeah, so, you know, and everyone's going, oh, a plastic spinner comes free with it. And then it was 2000, then for a while it was 2000 AD and Star-Lord. And then, yeah, and I've been reading it since basically the beginning. I kind of fell out of love with it in the late 90s, early 2000s.
Right. When I went to uni, I didn't last much longer than that because all my money went on beer. So I didn't even have comics money in those days. So wow. I dropped out, say, in the mid-90s. And it seemed to be going off the boil for me a bit then as well, it has to be said.
Yeah.
Certainly the Judge Dredd strip, which is... I started collecting around about the 400s, and then I immediately... Because they used to do a 2018 monthly, which reprinted most of the old Dredd strips. So I started collecting most of the old stories that way.
Yeah.
So I was really up with Judge Dredd. And then, as I say, I kind of fell out of love with it in the mid-90s. And then about 4 years ago, I think, they did one... Every so often they do a prog where it's all new strips.
Yes.
To encourage you to jump on.
That's right.
And I thought, oh, what the hell? You know, might pick up an issue. And it's like, oh, gosh, this is really good again, isn't it? And I've been getting it ever since. So I've got a huge gap in my knowledge of about 20, well, is it 1995 to 5 years ago? Yeah, it's about 20.
Wow. So 20 years. Because there was quite a few, I mean, you know, spoilers if anyone doesn't want to know about 2000 AD. But, I mean, there was quite a few major plot lines with Dredd, for example.
Yeah, I mean, I keep coming across stuff in the new, you know, in the modern stuff. I think suddenly he's got a niece. It's like, where did she come from? Well, what?
Well, strictly speaking, she's not really his niece. I mean, but anyway, no, there was a whole thing. A Day of Chaos was
one thing,
which was essentially Apocalypse War 2. Then there was before that you had Necropolis.
I got as far as Necropolis, and that's when they started crossing over with Judge Dredd Monthly as well, which knocked me slightly as well. It's like, oh, that's what the American comics do. That we should be above that.
Yeah, but Judge Dredd Monthly was actually a very good monthly series.
It still is the magazine. Yes, I get that now as well. Mm. But because I couldn't afford it at the time. I was really cheesed off that to try and follow this story, I was having to buy two different comics.
So. Yeah, Necropolis was kind of the drop off point for me for a bit, but things like things like this whole story with Judge Kraken, the dead man,
the dead man, that was just such a revelation. So clever. Yeah,
so clever. That was such a clever thing. And again, we're not spoiling it for anyone.
No.
But going back slightly to spaceships, I tell you one series I really did like, which in my opinion ended just at the right point but ended too soon, which was another sort of space war one called Bad Company.
Oh, yes. Which is still going.
It's still going? Recently.
Yes. Yeah, they also returned with post-traumatic stress disorder. And yeah.
But they were all dead.
some of them are, but some of them are more dead than others.
Well, I shouldn't be surprised in comics. Yeah, because comics. Yeah. But in the original three volumes that there were, it ended with Danny Franks essentially becoming the Cruel Heart.
Yes,
which was that was it. That was the end, and that was the wrap up. And in truth, it was also the thing that Mass Effect ripped off for its finale. But let's never go there again.
My problem with Batman, I was never a fan of the art at the time. I mean, now going back to it, I can appreciate it. But at the time, it was a bit too out there for me, I must admit. The eyes seemed to be off the bodies, and the Cruel themselves didn't seem to be a great design for an alien.
They looked a bit like sort of squashed Sontarans with one big eye.
Like sort of somebody dressed in a costume for a kiddie's party.
Yeah. Actually, they reminded me a lot of that Christopher Eccleston Doctor Who when the Daleks made pigmen.
Yeah, thanks for that reminder.
Yeah, there you go. Little pig with little pig head and in a big spacesuit, and it's sort of like the neck was kind of growing out of the
suit. With loads of eyes, some of which were off the body. I don't know.
Yeah, there was two glass shards or something that just would float off the corner of the eye at like a 1 o'clock position. It was weird, but I really enjoyed that. And they also had sort of that's what they looked like. They looked like critters, you know, the film Critters.
Yes, they did.
They looked like that. They had the big wide mouth that literally went from corner ear to ear.
I'll get an image to put on the Facebook. But
I think you're going to need like tons of these and save them all up, to be honest.
That's what I do these days.
But but the spaceships that were featured in Bad Company again were sort of abstract blocks that were kind of just like white spaces against the sky, and then you'd sort of see them drop off. You see, you know, the company gets sort of dropped off by a helicopter and then just goes away, and that's it. So it's always a bit of trouble. And then the most weirdest spacecraft I ever recall, and now I'm recalling it and Googling it at the same time, so I'm trying to find one, is the later Chaos Magic era of ABC Warriors.
Mm-hmm.
And Deadlock. You remember, we just before we went on air, we were talking about Deadlock. And Deadlock is like this mystical, like, necromancer agent of Chaos that later turned out to be the robot in spiritual embodiment of Nemesis the Warlock, for reasons that are far too convoluted to go into, but just say comics.
Yeah.
But he did some... He had a motorcycle.
Mm.
That was, like, literally, like, something that had just come off a Meatloaf album.
Yeah, and the front of it just looked like his head, didn't it?
That's right. And, yeah, and again, it was a space-worthy bike. I wonder how that would feature on our scoring system.
Right, a space bike.
Well, you know, realisation, interior and exterior, you got 100%, I guess, haven't you?
Because when he was on the moon, Dredd had a hover bike thing, didn't he? But
he did,
yeah,
but that wasn't...
That didn't go off the planet, though. So.
No, that just looked like a pair of inverted egg cups with a seat between it, if I remember correctly. I'm trying to think, because I know the one thing as a easily outraged comics fan at the time, when I started reading Lobo, I don't know if you remember him from the DC mm-hmm. comics. But when artist who was on ABC Warriors, Simon Bisley, at the time, moved from ABC Warriors to DC and then started doing Lobo, and then suddenly Lobo's got this interstellar motorcycle, I'm like, you unoriginal fuck.
Yeah, I'm afraid I was. Again, Bisley's were, and particularly on Slane. Well, Slane I've never particularly enjoyed anyway. I've never quite understood why that was in 2000 AD. Mm. Yeah, everybody was going crazy over that, and I was not worshipping at the Church of Bisley, I'm afraid.
No. I mean, I do. I find his artwork is kind of just fun.
A lot of it's like, look at the size of his knob, look at the size of her boobs, basically.
Well, yeah, it is a bit old-fashioned heavy metal sort of metal hurlant stuff. But I'll just because it'll help, and you can send this, put this in your little list. Here's Lobo's bike, and essentially, if you look at that, that is Deadlock's bike. It's basically a space bike.
And the quality of the other spaceships as well. Well done, Bisley. That's excellent.
But again, that's the kind of stuff that you'd see in like Nemesis mm-hmm. the Warlock, all that stuff that was going down the termite tubes. You know, essentially abstract shapes with
Kevin
some
O'Neill's
engines.
Stuff was better than that, but yeah, not by much, I grant you.
Yeah, so yeah, 2018. I mean, what was your favourite?
One of the strips is currently running at the moment, which I'm really enjoying, is called Scarlet Traces. And it's set in it's an alternate universe 1960s, basically.
Mm.
So a lot of the styling's around that, but the equipment they've got's a lot more futuristic. And we've got, like, there's a British colony on Mars and stuff like that. Well, and I've just sent you a picture of some really cool-looking spaceships from that.
Well, I didn't know Scarlet Traces was... nice. I didn't know Scarlet Traces was from 2000 AD, because I've got the collected works of Scarlet Traces, mm-hmm. because it's actually... a sort of unofficial sequel to War of the Worlds.
Yes, there is a lot of War of the Worlds stuff in it at the moment.
Yeah, and basically the first volume because I didn't know it came straight from 2000 AD, in which case I respect it even more now. But the first thing it basically starts off as like a Jack the Ripper style mystery in London, where basically people are being found, drained of their blood, but it's in London, which is now utilizing all the technology from the failed Martian invasion.
Yeah.
So everyone's walking around in like tripods, and you know, got all these kind of extra things, and they heat up their food using heat rays and all this kind of stuff. So imagine sort of a steampunk era Victorian technology, which has been sort of co-opted from the failed Martian war machines that are all left behind. And it turns out and I'm only saying this because this comic is now like about sort of 10 years old, but basically it turns out that Jack the Ripper isn't Jack the Ripper. What he actually is a Martian that the government managed to catch and inoculate and keep him tied up in a essentially a bell jar, and they feed him human blood to keep him alive with the sort of, well, we'll keep you alive and we will, you know, and you need to deconstruct all this technology for us. It's a massive conspiracy. So I don't know how it's been going now in the latest.
Now they're doing a lot of stuff about looking at, as 2000 AD often does, looking at the current state of politics in a very futuristic way and looking at issues of, you know, immigrants and reflecting all that on the war on Mars and stuff. Colonialism and that sort of thing. It's interesting stuff, but with really cool looking spaceships, so it keeps my interest.
Oh, nice.
And cool. The art's really good. It's really cool.
Oh, by the way, I found a picture of I found a picture of Deadlock's bike. Hold on, this is with the wheels down, so it's slightly off the boil, as it were. It's not quite there, but you can see that. It's someone's been watching a bit too much Lord of the Rings with Nazguls and what have you, and a bit. It's a bit all over the place. It's kind of like, how can I put it? It's like someone's started drawing a tiger, then got about halfway through and thought, actually, I want to draw a Nazgul from Lord of the Rings, and then got halfway through that and then went, actually, I wanted to do a jet ski.
Yeah. And completely then impractical.
And then realised that somewhere along the line it was supposed to be a bike, so stuck a bike wheel on the back.
And then, of course, the engine has to have a big dick because it's Bisley.
Well, yeah, pretty much. And at least one skull. Weirdly or inappropriately placed, and a hook. So that's that. What other ships do you have for 2000 AD, sir?
I think that's pretty much all I could come up with. Because as I say, they don't do a lot of ships, sadly.
No, they don't. I mean, it's kind of a weird one, isn't it? Because we're sort of talking about ships, but we're not really. I mean, I'll tell you what. I'll pass you this picture, which is from DR and Quinch. And for those of you who don't know DR and Quinch is, basically, it's two sort of 50s rockers from the future, from an alien world where they all speak like sort of 50s sort of greaser gangs, and they're just irresponsible idiots flying through time and just fucking things up. And
yeah, but again, that image says it all, doesn't it? There's plenty of, they've concentrated on the T-Rex, on the characters, but the ship itself is...
But the ship itself is just a collection of parts and basically a bubble. A bubble with some engine bits and a face. Yeah, why do you think that is, though, just out of interest? Why do you think they don't...
I think they're just not interested in ships, is the bottom line. It's that, you know, because ironically, 2000 AD... launched pretty much the time when Star Wars took off. Their timing was impeccable. As with many things in 2000 AD, or by accident, of course. But you know, but the writers weren't really interested in producing your standard sci-fi stories. And they weren't even. I mean, Rogue Troop is an interesting example because that a lot of them came at the writers and the artists came out of the World War II comics. Rogue Troop is kind of like, you know, a sci-fied up version of that. But even then, it's focused on ground battles. It's not focused on battles in space. So they've never really done an awful lot of space stuff, unless there was a lot of stuff in the gap that I missed.
No.
I mean, even stuff like Sam Slade Robo Hunter, which I dearly love. Really, there's not much in the way of ship stuff there.
No.
That one's all about the robots. So
yeah, and then there was also the adaptation of the Stainless Steel Rat with Slippery Jim DeGriz, and he had a ship, but again, it was kind of never really. He never seemed to be consistent from one frame to the next.
Yeah.
The other one I'm thinking of is Halo Jones, and I can't remember if there was a spaceship in that.
Now which artist was that again?
That was
Ian somebody, wasn't it?
Blimey, hold on, I'm just gonna try and...
He did a bit of Dread as well, I remember.
Yeah, wasn't it Mike McMahon?
Drawn by Ian Gibson.
There you go, that's it. But again, you know, it was all set on these fantastical worlds and futuristic planets and what have you.
They were like ringed space stations in that one.
That's right, yeah.
But again, the ships are just blobs, really.
Yeah, well, actually, I've got a fantastic one here. And if I was a gambling man, and I knew the timing didn't work out, I'd say that someone had been watching Galaxy Quest. But hold on a second, let me pass you this. But obviously, Galaxy Quest came out way later than Halo Jones. But the spaceship, the Lonely Star, you know.
Yeah, I see what you mean, yeah, with the engines.
The engines, yeah. I mean, it's kind of a weird-looking thing, but you can also see in that the secondary hull of the Enterprise.
Mm. It's like, but you can also see the artist really didn't care.
Yeah, you can also see that there is no symmetry or rhyme or reason to that whatsoever. Yeah, it's definitely an encumbrance rather than something they wanted to focus on, isn't it?
So I think our bottom line is, with 2008, it's worth reading for the stories, which are really cool.
Without a doubt.
And particularly sort of, they do a lot of sort of commentary on current day issues.
Yeah.
But if it's not worth reading for spaceships.
No. If you want to, yeah, I mean, like I say, Halo Jones with the Lonely Star ship, you know, it's probably about as close as you get to anything kind of resembling. Because there's a few more shots of it elsewhere if you go looking for it. But, it is really basically someone just lost their set square and tried to draw the Enterprise without the saucer on it. I mean, just so you liked, you just before we go, I mean, you liked Robot Hunter, yeah?
Yeah, Sam Slade, yeah.
Sam Slade. So what was the one series that, because there's always one series in 2000 AD where you start reading it and you slavishly follow it to the end.
Well, originally it was definitely Rogue Trooper, but that went off the boil again in the 90s. They kind of relaunched it with a new Rogue Trooper called Friday
or FR1DAY. Yeah,
it was poop. So ultimately it became Judge Dredd and remains Judge Dredd. I mean, even if the other strips are naff, you've always got, particularly now, you've got John Wagner back writing most of the stories as well.
Yeah.
Because he sort of took a time off for a while, I think, in the 90s, and it suffered a lot as a result. But now it's top-notch stuff again.
Yeah. I mean, for me, it was always, I always used to read the Tharg's Future Shocks. I loved them and some of the stuff that was in there. But for a good long while, there was Nemesis the Warlock. There was Bad Company, which I saw through to the end. I'm not caring. I don't care they brought it back.
I think Danny's still dead, just to reassure you.
Oh, well, that's good. At least
some
that's
of the others aren't.
No. Don't bring back Thrax. Thrax went down as a proper hero after all that. And if he's come back, oh, for God's sakes.
I don't think so, but yeah.
But anyway, but the other one was, which has got nothing to do with spaceships, was Zenith.
Yeah, which I've not read since I was in the comic, because, of course, famously, it was a long while before they've only just recently been able to reprint it.
Yeah.
But and I wasn't a fan at the time, but I suspect I'd enjoy it a lot more now, because I was interested in spaceships, and it was really a looking at superheroes in a sideways fashion.
Yeah, it was kind of superheroes crossed with Lovecraftian horror.
Yeah.
That's the thing I always appreciated it. That sort of started off in World War II when the British and the Germans have suddenly evolved like two superheroes who fight to the death, and it turns out they've been dabbling in forces they know not what, and to create superhumans, and actually one of them might contain like some kind of many angled beast from a dimension which, you know, Lovecraft would have probably adored. But I used to love that. I used to love that series. I mean, I really liked Ballad of Halo Jones. In all those cases, Zenith, Nemesis, Halo Jones, they all actually ended. Well, Halo Jones just kind of stopped because Alan Moore.
And they've never brought that one back.
Which is, no, I doubt they would ever do that. But yeah, so a lot of time with, and now going backwards, because I've now collecting all the bigger issues, and luckily every birthday someone kindly gets me a new volume. So it's just
I'm having to keep track. Yeah. I don't get the same one.
So, I have to say, I'm really enjoying 2000 AD again, and I really want to get back into the magazine again because I love Devil in War. I always thought he was kind of a strange character, sort of started off as like a Justice Department exorcist.
Yeah.
And then he got bitten by vampires, and now he's a vampire Justice Department exorcist.
There's a really good one at the moment called Marshall Lawson, which is set on a colony. And it's, as with a lot of the strips in the magazine, it's tangentially connected with Dredd. This one actually more so than some of the others, but she's in charge of, it's very like much like a Western, basically.
Oh, right.
She's in charge of this distant colony and dealing with the lawlessness of the place that she's been placed in charge as Marshall. It's really fantastic stuff. The art is beautiful. It's written by the guy who writes a lot of the Warhammer 40k books.
Oh,
Andy, tell me the name.
Hold on, Marshall. I'm looking at. I'm now Lawson.
Does a lot of writing for the magazine and 2000 AD these days.
Magazine. Man looks up thing on internet.
Yes, clicky clicky.
Yeah. Marshall Lawson, a Carlos Esquerra, does some of the stuff. Marshall Meta Lawson.
Mm-hmm.
Oh, that's it. Oh, I'm looking at the art. That's lovely.
Yeah,
I'm liking that. Who wrote it, though? Who wrote it? Richard Bruton? Or is that just someone's blog?
No, well, blog. It's not. It's whoever. It's the current writer that's the...
Hold on. Hold on, I'm still getting there. Not really telling you who's written it. That's great. Thank you, 2018.
Judge Dredd Wiki, you fail.
You have failed.
And all my comics are upstairs in the bedroom, so it'd be a long pause if I went and got them and looked at them. So.
Yeah. Oh, it's Dan Abnett.
Dan Abnett, there you are.
There you go. Dan Abnett, there you go. Cool. Well, that's even more reason to read it then. And I hope they collect that up because I'm kind of guessing that it's a bit late to jump in on that. But anyway, I think that's about it, isn't it?
I think so. As I say, I mean, the basic conclusion is it's a great comic, but not necessarily if you want to go to it for spaceships.
No, but there are spaceships in it. But, you know, maybe we've missed some. Maybe you know some. Maybe you've been all shouting at your podcast device going, no, you fucking idiots, didn't you miss this ship? In which case, let us know what you think. Post up your thoughts and your comments about this minisode or anything 2000 AD related onto our Facebook group, which is facebook.com/group/spacedrokkjury, or swear at Pete on Twitter, which is at Space Drokk Jury, because basically he's taken over again, and I think the interaction from me and Andy has been low to no at this point.
There was some today. I don't know if it was you or Andy, but
it was definitely Andy. Then it wouldn't have been me. At the moment, I'm currently any human interaction I have is either shouting or crying. So it's, you know, this is a first for me this week. So do let us know, get in contact with us on the usual channels, and, you know, do stay tuned for our next episode, which will be next week, and I think it'll be interesting. If I'm looking at the schedule correctly, I think I'm going to bring my own space station.
Aha, it's that one, is it?
Yes. Okay. And arguments shall be had. Anyway, until next time, thanks very much for listening. Thank you, Pete, and we'll catch you all next time. Daddy bye.
Cheer bye.
Space Drokk Jury is a production of Three Angry Beards for GeekPlanetOnline.com.